So yesterday I was telling you about the fitness trade-offs of viruses across different host species and how what factors might determine the probability of a virus jumping from one host to another. But most of viruses, most of the ecology of viruses basically relies in a single host species, or in very few, but mostly in a single host species. So you think in human rhinovirus, for instance, or human herpes virus, those are human viruses. They only have a host, which are humans. And they replicate in this host, and they move from individual to individual, and they spread epidemiologically and induce diseases. So the question is, and this is a kind of obvious question, is obvious for epidemiologists, it's obvious for clinical doctors, that not all of us are equal in terms of our ability to respond to infection. Obviously, there is genetic differences among us that made some of us more sensitive to infection with a given virus, and some others more resistant to infection. I'm sure that some of you here in the room every year get the flu, while some other people never get the flu. It's the same virus, genetic variation, of course, and we are the same species, but obviously we have differences in genetic susceptibility to infection. And this genetic susceptibility to differences in genetic susceptibility to infection, they have important implications both for the virus and the host species. And this is a slide only with text where I'm going to enumerate those consequences. So, for instance, if there is heterogeneity in response to infection, this heterogeneity might select for a monomorphic generalist population. So that means a virus that is able of infecting every possible genotype of the host. Okay, that could be a possibility. So we select a virus, or the population of host selects for a virus that is a generalist. Remember, what is a generalist? It's able of infecting every possible genotype of the host, but they don't do really, really well. Or they might select, heterogeneous population of hosts might select for polymorphic population of viruses composed by a specialist on each one of the possible hosts. So in other words, there is a population of viruses which is highly variable, highly polymorphic, and each one of the genotypes in the viral population is able of infecting one or very few of the potential genotypes of the host. And others simply don't infect. Okay? Or finally, we can the system can select for a monomorphic population composed by a specialist, which is a specialist for the most abundant susceptible host. Okay? That means that there is a poor guy among the host that gets all the infections, whereas all the other members of the host population usually never get infected. This is not stable because basically depending on the virulence, depending on the aggressivity of the virus, this is not an stable situation because obviously this genotype of the host will disappear and the resistant host will survive. So what determines each one of these possible outcomes of evolution? Well, factors that determine the outcome of evolution are the relative abundance and productivity of each of the host genotypes. So that means that if there is a very susceptible host that is a very high frequency, that means that the virus will spread and basically infect everyone in the population, whereas if the most susceptible host has a very low frequency in the population, the rest of the population will remain non-infected and the incidence of the disease will be low. The rate of transmission, obviously, is important, the gene flow in terms of viral population here, and whether co-infection and superinfection are frequent. The rate of transmission means that some viruses are more easy to transmit than others. Flu is easy to transmit. Flu just transmits by air, if you are infected and touch your mouth or nose and then touch some surface and somebody comes after you and touches, it's really easy to transmit. Some other viruses like hepatitis C, it needs to be transmitted by blood. So you need to be infected in a transfusion or by sharing syringes with if you are a drug user or something like that. But they are more difficult to transmit. And co-infection, super-infection means that some genotypes of the virus might be weak in terms of not being able of infecting everyone, but they might be able of infecting a host that is already compromised because has been already infected by another genotype of the virus. So whether the virus is produce single or multiple infections is also relevant in this this question. The competition between viral phenotypes. So if you have two genotypes of the virus that are infecting the same host, obviously they start competing each other. And the consequence, the result of that competition, as we have been, as I illustrated these last 2 days, the consequence of this result is that the fitness of the virus will increase within a host. And the fittest one will outcompete the weakest one, the less fit one, with the result of evolving viruses which are more and more and more virulent, simply because a consequence of infection within the host. Another factor is the heritability of the host range. So whether the virus is, well, basically what I showed you yesterday. So the virus fixes mutations that determine that it is better infecting a given host genotype than others. Yesterday I illustrated with different species of the host, but you can imagine the same for different genotypes of the virus. So if the virus fixes mutations that are always transmitted to the progeny and allow the virus to infect a particular genotype that has a high heritability, and then that just means that that genotype of the virus will persist. And finally, where there are fitness trade-offs in the fitness of the viruses across the different genotypes of the host. So we can imagine, in theory, genotypes of the host that are more resistant because they are expressing a certain resistant gene. This is common in plants, either natural resistant genes or artificially introduced resistant genes. And then there is a resistant breaking strain of the virus that is able of infecting the resistant plant, otherwise resistant plant, whereas there are other viruses that are not able, the wild-type viruses are not able of infecting this particular resistant genotype of the plant. In terms of virulence, at the end, what is important from a clinical perspective is the virulence, how much damage the virus produces on the host. This host heterogeneity also has impact in terms of virulence. For instance, a strong host immunity exacerbates selection for virulence. So the stronger the defense of the host, the more likely the virus is to become virulent. So it has to break more barriers in order to infect, and that means it's going to be probably more damaging for the host. There is lots of theory about these particular points. I'm just mentioning a couple here. Sylvain Gandon and Andrew Reed has published a lot of theory on this possibility. There's another consequence is that virulence will escalate up in homogeneous populations. So if everybody in the population is equally susceptible to infection, so there is no genetic variability for resistant to infection, then viruses compete each other for the new host. So they simply, by competition, improve their fitness and they improve their, or they increase in virulence. So homogeneous populations usually tend to select for more virulent viruses. And this is work that Dieter Eber or Ronald Regaux has published about that, I mean, theory about that. If you have an heterogeneous population of hosts, virulence cannot be maintained at an intermediate level in every possible genotype of the host. So it will be genotypes in which the virus will be more virulent and in other genotypes where the virus will be less virulent. But it is not possible because, and this situation creates variants in virulence and then selection on that variance in virulence will again increase virulence overall. And the work that illustrates the theory that shows this is the case is by Martin Novak and Troy Day and others. And finally, whether virulence scales up or slides down to intermediate levels ultimately depends on the trade-off between replication among hosts. So at the end, everything depends on, again, on trade-offs. If you think the word trade-off has appeared here twice, and this slide is the same that I used yesterday, so it's just to remember you what is a trade-off in fitness. So in this, yesterday I used this slide talking about different species, but you can imagine the same discussion, the same arguments, considering this age as genotypes of the same species. Okay, so some virus might be a specialist because it infects better some genotypes than others, and a virus might be a generalist because it infects equally well every possible genotype. So now the question is, okay, that seems to be an interesting problem to address experimentally, because when you go to the literature, there's lots of theories, but there is very little data that specifically address this type of questions. So we decided to start a project, a long-term project, to study the effect of variability in the host susceptibility to infection on the evolution of viruses. So how the variability in the host species modifies the fitness and the virulence of the viral populations. And because we have to work with plant viruses right now, and our system, TEV, tobacco edge virus, the system we do most of our work, is not infecting Arabidopsis in a natural manner, we decided to create an Arabidopsis virus. Believe me, when you live in an institute where everybody's a plant biologist working with Arabidopsis, they hate you by creating an Arabidopsis virus. Anyhow, so why Arabidopsis? Well, Arabidopsis, I don't think I need to convince you, Arabidopsis is the plant in capital letters. Okay? Everything is known about Arabidopsis. You have genotypes, thousands of genotypes characterized, sequence. You know basically each gene in the plant, what it's doing. You have all the genetic tools for transforming the plants, for analyzing the plants. So it's the perfect model organism in plant biology. I don't know if the perfect, but it's at least is the best use, the most used and the best known. So we decided to work with Arabidopsis. This is just a picture of our virus, tobacco edge in this case, and this is a scheme of the genome. As I told you the other day, it's just, it is 9.5 kbs, it's really tiny. It has a single open reading frame, which is translated into a big polyprotein that self-processes in the mature peptides, which each one is indicated here. Just for curiosity, this is the coat protein that makes the filaments. It's a very simple virus. It's just an RNA molecule with a filament of proteins around, nothing else. This is the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. This is a protease that chops everything. This is the movement protein. It's the protein that the virus used to move from cell to cell in plants by modifying the plasmodesmata. You remember plasmodesmata, the holes that connects the cells. And the only important gene here is HCC-Pro. This is the suppressor of RNA silencing. One of the major defenses of plants, as I will mention later, against viruses is RNA silencing. So basically, a small RNA is guiding against the RNA genome and degrading the RNA genome. And the virus has a protein, HCC-Pro, that blocks the defense. Okay? It's an anti-defense protein, if you want. Plus other things. Every protein has multiple functions. HCC-Pro, no. HCC-Pro is the helper component, which is the bridge. Well, the whole virus makes this thing. It's only a protein and makes these spirals. There is no icosahedral capsid in that sense, no. From cell to cell can move the viral particle, the spiral, and or RNA. Both things can move. By the insects, aphids. When aphids feed on the plant, they suck the virus, they retain on the stylet, then they transmit. So this is Arabidopsis. Well, before I get into Arabidopsis, TB infects a number of species in nature, but experimentally it infects more species, although all natural hosts are solanaceae. So remember tobacco, nicotiana, ventamiana, tomato, pepper, things like that. Arabidopsis is a brassica, which belongs to a different order than the solanaceae. within the Magnoliopsida class. So you correct me if I'm wrong, Magnus, but I think that jumping from Solanaceae to Brassica is like jumping from lizards to humans, something like that, at that level. And why Arabidopsis? Well, besides all the details I already mentioned, the good experimental system it is, it turns out that some people, actually Jim Carrington and Francois Revers, they have been working with Arabidopsis as an infection model system for TB. Basically, it's this kind of experiments that I was mentioning this morning where somebody has a virus and then says, well, what can I infect? Arabidopsis. Why somebody thought infecting TB in Arabidopsis? That's not my problem. But the thing is that Jim Carrington, working with TB and Arabidopsis, he characterized three loci which were involved in the susceptibility to infection in Arabidopsis by TB. Different accessions or isolates of Arabidopsis, different types of Arabidopsis, they differ in these genes. And depending on the combination, and I'll tell you a little bit more about the genetics right now, in a moment, depending on the combination, they are supporting local infection, only the inoculated leaf, or systemic infection. So the virus is able of exiting the inoculated leaf and moving up to and colonize the entire plant. Which are these genes? The RTM. RTM stands for restricted tobacco H virus movement genes. RTM1 is a jacqueline-related lectin-like protein, which is a recognition involved in recognizing pathogens, PAMs, and then is involved in stress response. It's in chromosome 1. RTM2 is a heat shock protein-like, which is with a transmembrane domain, which has been also associated to response to stress. It's in chromosome 3. RTM3 has this long name. It's a meprinam traf homology math domain-containing protein, a very long name, and basically it's a protein that is involved in the processing of ubiquitination. So it's ubiquitinating proteins and deriving them into the degradation pathways. And this is in chromosome 3. RTM4 and RTM5 were recently described by Francois Revers because their phenotypic effect, but they have not been characterized to the molecular level yet. So let me call them ecotypes because it's what came to my mouth. When one ecotype of the plant contains a dominant allele at each one of the five loci, then the plant is fully resistant to infection. Okay? The best you can get is a few cells infected in the inoculated leaf. Okay, so if you have something like this, this RTM1, RTM2, RTM3, for now let's stop like that. Okay, this guy will be resistant. This guy will be also resistant. So if he has a mutation there. Usually mutations are deletions. All the mutations that have been sequenced, they are deletions in this gene, in this region, partial deletion. So this will be resistant too. But if you have something like this, a double mutant for any one of the locus. So this, for instance, also will be okay. This will be also sensitive to infection. Well, whenever you have a mutation in homozygosity, the plant is susceptible to systemic infection. Okay? So this is what they say here. So with all this information in hand, we decided to start our experiments using Landsberger ECTA which is a double mutant RTM1. It's a deletion in the RTM1 locus. Okay? So Lansbury recta was already described by Jim Carrington as systematically susceptible to tobacco age. Okay? So this is the experimental system. We have a tobacco a genotype of the plant that is susceptible to infection. We have other genotypes of the plant that are not susceptible to infection or not to the same extent. And then we have a virus, which is not an Arabidopsis virus. So first the thing to do is to transform the Arabidopsis virus, to evolve the Arabidopsis virus, the tobacco virus, into an Arabidopsis virus. How you do that? Very simple. It's just a serial passage experiment. Just let natural selection do the job for you. Okay, you just simply take the virus. As I said yesterday, we have the virus in a vector, so in a plasmid, we can do things with it. And we inoculated a tobacco plant simply to produce a huge amount of viral particles, in the order of 10 to the 12 viral particles. And then we took those viral particles and inoculated hundreds of Lansbury recta plants. We allowed the infection to proceed. We were every day looking at the plants, searching for symptoms, searching for any evidence of infection, because Carrington has described some symptoms, some really weak symptoms, but we couldn't see any symptom at all. So at some point, we decided to molecularly make a diagnosis of infection based on molecular techniques. Precisely in the technique known as Western blot, which is detecting a viral protein. So during Western blot for all these hundreds of plants, we found 7 plants that were infected. So at least the viral protein was there, so the plant was infected and accumulated viruses. So we took each one of these plants, here indicated by red arrows, and used them to inoculate another bunch of plants. In this case, just 10 plants of each. So this one went to 10, this went to 10, and so on and so forth. And we allow for infection to proceed, and again, repeat the same process. If we saw symptoms, fantastic, we know we were infection. If we didn't show symptoms, we determined it molecularly. The presence or absence of the virus was determined with a molecular technique. Some of the lineages, and then repeat this process again and again and again. Some of the 7 lineages got extinct. We were not able to maintain the virus through time simply because the amount of viral particles produced in a plant were lost when we did the purification. You have to purify the virus, and this is a destructive technique, so you lose part of the material. So we were not able of transmitting the virus. Either that or because the inoculum size was so low that the plant defenses were able of controlling the infection and just clear the infection. But one of the lineages, one of them, kept going for a number of generations, and symptoms appear, and then it was apparently a much easier infection to go, and then we decided to characterize that particular lineage after 17 passages. And we call this virus ATB-8017. So here are some data showing you how the new virus looks like. In this graph, I'm plotting 2 typical virus properties, okay? 2 characteristics that virologists use commonly to describe viruses. One is the pathogenicity. That means the percentage of plants infected with a fixed amount of RNA, of virus material. And here is the production of viral particles, of infectious viral particles, okay? Not anything that is produced, but only those that are infectious. It's called lesion-forming units. So basically, in this axis, you have here the ancestral virus, the TEV, the Carrington virus. It has a low infectivity, below 20%, and the evolved virus has an infectivity which is 100%. So with the same amount of RNA, here you infect a few plants. With the same amount of RNA, here you infect everything. And what about the accumulation of the virus? This ancestral virus accumulated, this is in log scale, it accumulated like 20 LFU per milligram, where the Ebola virus was over 2,000 LFUs per milligram. So it's like 100 times more accumulation in one case than other. So we have a virus that is more infectious and is more productive. And how about the symptoms? What about the symptoms? This is a picture, it's an old picture, and here you have a non-infected plant, and this is a detail of one of the leaves of the rosette. No, false. It's one of the leaves of the caulinar stems. So this is a non-infected plant, it's a plant infected with ancestral virus, and this is a plant infected with Ebola virus. Okay? On the same age. And this is a detail of basically the same leaf from the same spot. So you don't need to be a plant pathologist to recognize that this has very severe symptoms compared with that. Okay. We sequenced the virus to see what was there, and these are the six mutations I was telling you yesterday. Okay. So this, there are six mutations in the genome. They are synonymous mutations, non-synonymous mutations, those I described to you yesterday in the context of the empirical fitness landscapes. And basically these mutations, if you produce, so the beauty of viruses again is that because we have infectious clones, you can move mutations to your clone and characterize the fitness effect of each mutation by themselves or in combinations. And here, what we did is create each one of the singles in the ancestral background, and there is no symptoms. Okay, the only mutation that induces symptoms is this one here, which is a non-synonymous mutation in the BPG protein. Okay, it's a leucine biphenylalanine change. That mutation by itself induces symptoms. Here is a picture of the wild-type virus. The BPG mutation, okay, here. You can already see how this plant is different from this plant in terms of size and in terms of the leaves and so on. Leaves here are now starting to be curved and things like that. But this is the only mutation that by itself produces symptoms. But we created the double mutants, and every time that we combine this mutation, the BPG mutation, with any other non-synonymous mutations, the symptoms simply got worse. And here you have an example of a double mutant with the BPG plus the P3 mutation. You see this plant, the stems now start, they don't grow straight, but they just curve down. You see, they just curve down. And the siliquots, where the seeds are, they are not straight siliquots anymore, but they start curving also. And when you have the triple mutant, so the three non-synonymous mutations, basically this is the result. And this is a phenocopy of the AT17 virus. So these three mutations by themselves are enough to explain the phenotype that we are observing. Any question, any doubt? No, we never did. This is a question that I always get. I never did. We never did. So I don't know which one got first. That's the answer to your, basically the answer to your question. So next question we ask ourselves was, okay, now we have a virus that we can certainly, call an Arabidopsis virus. And we have the ancestral, its direct ancestral, which was a tobacco virus. And how do they interact with the plant in terms of gene expression of the plant, in terms of which genes the plant is expressing as a response to infection in one case versus the other? Remember what I said this morning when we were doing the meta-analysis comparing the expression of Arabidopsis infected by viruses that have never seen Arabidopsis in nature. Now we have a virus that is Arabidopsis and its direct ancestor, which is not an Arabidopsis virus. So now we can do a direct comparison of the changes in the way the plant is responding to two viruses that are related genetically, but one is Arabidopsis virus and the other not. I'm not going to, so we did transcriptomics using the microarrays, which was the technology available at that time. And I'm not going, and classify the genes in categories according to their patterns of gene expression for the non-infected, infected with ancestral, infected with evolved. I'm not going to bore you with all the details, but just want you to focus on these particular two patterns. Okay? Look at these two patterns, please. What you have here is genes that were increasing expression when the plants were infected by the ancestral virus. Okay? They increase infection here and here. But they go back to the non-infected status, or close to it, when the virus infecting is the evolved virus. So genes that respond up, overexpressing when the plant was infected with ancestral, but they are not being expressed when the plant is infected by the evolved virus. Which genes are there? Okay? You can do a gene ontology, you can see which biological functions are there. There's more information in this table that you really need, so focus only on the yellow lines, because are the relevant ones. So what category, what functions are here? Remember, that's important. Functions that were expressed when the plants were infected by the ancestral, but they are not expressed when the plants are infected by the evolved virus. What is there? Response to hormones, so signaling, response to infection, MAP-KKK, so phosphatase cascades, or signaling, systemic acquired resistance, and innate immune resistance. So everything that is related with signaling and the specific responses to infection. Systemic acquired resistance is the protein-based resistance of the plants. It's basically mediating apoptosis and things like that. So it's an anti-infection strategy. It's not specific of viruses. It works also for fungi and for bacteria. But it's a mechanism of resistance. And another one that is activated is the, which was activated by the ancestral, but is not activated by the evolved, is the innate immune resistance. And what is inside here is RNAi. So if you look at the genes that are there, is AGO, DCL, RDR6, and all these kind of genes involved in the silencing pathways. So how do we interpret this? Our interpretation is that the the ancestral virus enters the plant, tries to replicate, initiates replication, but it goes so slow and so poorly that the plant mounts all the defenses and blocks the infection. The plant responds to infection. Whereas the evolved virus, it goes so fast, it replicates at such a speed and spreads so quickly from cell to cell, that basically the plant is always a step behind the virus. The virus is dismounting the defenses before the plant is able of transmitting information from cell to cell. So this is our interpretation of this study. Questions? So, one obvious step. Now we have a virus that is an Arabidopsis virus. I mean, it's still called tobacco edge, but it's an Arabidopsis isolate of tobacco edge. So remember how we decided to work with Lance Vererecta, because this RTM loci. And as I said, there are many other ecotypes of Arabidopsis that they contain the right RTM combination, so they are resistant to infection. Remember, whenever you have the wild type alleles, you are resistant to infection. So the obvious question now is, okay, this was determined with the ancestral virus. How is going to behave our evolved virus on the other Arabidopsis ecotypes? So basically, we took a collection, some accessions or some ecotypes of Arabidopsis, okay? That were in my institute, some of them, I mean, they have, we took some of the many that they have, not all. So these numbers, and here is how the ancestral virus infects. So nothing, 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 nothing. Lungs very erecta, below 20%, obviously, nothing, nothing. And Stockholm zero, it turns out that we observe this high infection, we sequence, and it turns out that Stockholm zero has a deletion in homozygosis here, in RTM3. What happened with the Ebola virus? Basically, you can infect everything. With a big variance. There's a big variance among ecotypes. So some ecotypes are infected very poorly, 7%, 9%, 6%, but others, well, this is obviously Landsberg, so almost 100%, but there are others like this AFL2, which went from nothing to 50%, or Dijon 2 from nothing to 41%, or Alcalá from nothing to almost 40%, nothing to 22%, nothing to 43%. So the Ebola virus has acquired the ability to infect not only Landsberg erecta, but many other ecotypes. Yeah, we know all this, the RTM for all this. Yeah, that was published by Reverse. Because whatever is the RTM gene doing, but because the mechanism of how the virus and the RTM gene interact is not completely clear, okay? So, but remember, they are kind of, RTM1 was a membrane protein involved in detection of pumps and things like that, or detect and involved in response. Whatever they did is, they are not interacting correctly with this virus as they did interact with the ancestral one. It's something in the change of the virus. Either it runs fast, it replicates faster and saturates the system with viral particles, and that forces the RTM enzymes to bind them and move, or whatever. We don't know. But the fact is that, whatever was the mechanism with ancestral doesn't work with the Ebola virus. And this has something, I mean, this in terms of, you know, sometimes people tend to believe that they try, people working on resistance, not only in plants, okay, this is a general thing. They tend to say, okay, this is resistant to, this genotype is resistant to this virus. Okay, exactly that, to this particular genotype of the virus, but not to the virus, because the virus might have other genotypes able of infecting, as is the case here. Okay. What about the symptoms? You can see some symptoms here. This is Landsberg erecta, so remember the very severe symptoms. Columbia zero, it has mild symptoms. Alcalá has severe symptoms. Cabo Verde has basically or no symptoms, or mild symptoms, and so on. So, like mild symptoms, Cabo Verde, this one here, okay? Moderate symptoms, Colombia, OI, ANTA here, and severe symptoms, Landsberg, Alcalá, Stockholm, and WS. So there's variation in the symptoms with the virus, okay? So instead of doing with 9 genotypes, we do with 900. That will be good enough to mapping where are the genes. So next step was, okay, now we see differences in symptoms and in the way the virus infects different ecotypes of the plant. So we ask ourselves, do infection also correlates with a change in the patterns of gene expression? And to do that, we got back to the transcriptomic analysis, and we did we characterized the transcriptome of plants infected from different ecotypes. These three ecotypes belong to the severe group, what I will call the severe group from now on, and these three belong to the mild group from now on. So basically, we did the transcriptomics, we produced the list of genes with altered expression, and then using a similarity score, the same one I explained this morning, we computed pairwise differences between the list of genes, and then we built these two little cladograms, one for overexpressed genes and one for underexpressed genes, and basically the ecotypes cluster according to the gene expression cluster according with the symptoms group. So plants showing strong symptoms cluster together, or the gene expression of plants with strong symptoms is more similar than with plants with mild symptoms. So basically, probably it's a question of the severity of symptoms, what they do. So you can do a functional annotation of these genes, and then basically this is for overexpressed genes, okay, for this group here, for these genes here. For overexpressed genes, what do you have there? They are a group of responses that were common for all, but there's a group of responses that is only common for the group S, the severe responses that is only common for the mild symptoms. What is there? For the mild symptoms, basically what you have is defense genes. So here is this is in Spanish. Well, doesn't matter. Systemic acquired resistant, response to fungi, innate immune resistant, response to bacteria, immune response, and things like that. So basically the M, the mild group, what is overexpressing is defenses. Okay? Where the severe group, what is overexpressing up here is metabolism, auxin metabolism, cell wall metabolism, ethylene metabolism, and some other metabolisms over there. So this is kind of compatible with the idea that the mild group is has lower susceptibility, whereas the severe group has more easy to infect, and the response is more on the tolerance than on the whatever response to infection. So this is basically telling the same history. So, okay, so we got to the point that we were interested to arrive when I started my talk. So we have now a virus that is an Arabidopsis virus, and we have genetically diverse plants, okay? Plants that differ in their response to infection. So they differ in the infectivity of the virus. Remember the table I showed you with infectivities. They also differ in the metabolic response to infection. So we have plants that differ in their susceptibility and response to infection and the virus. So now we can do the experiment of evolving the virus on different plants and see how that affects the fitness and the virulence of the virus. So the question that we want to ask is whether a more susceptible genotype of the plant will select for less virulent viruses, whereas a more resistant genotype of the plant will select for more virulent viruses. Okay, that's the type of question we want to answer. This is the experimental design. Again, it's very simple, conceptually. We started with our Lansbury recta zero isolated virus, and then we split the virus into lineages, evolving lineages, on different ecotypes of the plant. DI2, which is a severe plant, A2, which is a mild symptom plant, Lansbury, ST0, severe, and WT, mild. So there is three independent lineages per plant genotype, and then we run the experiment for 20 passages. Okay? At the end of the 20 passages, we started characterizing the evolved population, starting with fitness. So we did all the fitness assays, taking in this column every one of the evolved lineages, and infecting plants from each one of the potential hosts. Okay? So in the diagonal, in the gray boxes, what you have is the fitness on the local host, being the local host, the one that was experienced by the virus during evolution. So the DI2 lineage 1 measuring the eye, so you see all the fitness values in the diagonal, but also the fitness of these lineages outside the local host. Okay? So this is, I mean, this is a lot of information in this table, and if you are interested in them, in the details, you can always go to this paper and read the bit about the details, about the statistics and all the, what we did on this data. But I want to summarize this large amount of data into a few figures that will be more illustrative of the results. That is the statistics. About the specificity of adaptation. So what I'm showing in this figure, just pay attention to the left part of the slide, is the fitness in the local host versus the average fitness across hosts, okay? In the alternative hosts. So remember the trade-off that we have been talking about these days. If by improving your fitness in a particular host, you lose or you never adapt to alternative hosts, you expect a negative correlation. So in other words, the more, the fitter you are in one particular host, the less fit you will be in the alternatives and vice versa. And this is exactly what we have here. So there is a significant negative correlation here. So the, these guys, the ST0 lineages, this is the average of the ST0 lineages across ST and across the, all the other hosts. So the ST0 lineages, they got the highest fitness possible in their local host in ST, but they are the lowest fitness across any other host. Whereas these guys up here, D and maybe Landsberg, they have the highest fitness across hosts, but they are not particularly better in their own host than they are in the alternative hosts. So there is a negative correlation. This negative correlation is even more obvious if instead of fitness, you look at virulence. Being in this case virulence, the reduction in plant size. Okay, so basically you take the plant, the infected plant, you cut it, and you measure the size of the plant. I mean the weight of the plant. Sorry, you just weight the plant compared with a non-infected plant. Okay, so and the correlation is even more obvious. So whatever is more virulent in the local host is less virulent in the alternative host. And whatever is less virulent in the local host is more or less equally virulent across every possible host. Okay, so it's a trade-off in adaptation. So we can do a little bit more of, or we can go to a little bit of theory at this point. And this is some theory that you can expand reading this really good paper from Joshua Weiss, which was published a number of years ago in Trends in Microbiology, where basically you can address question, you can address another type of questions by looking at the data in specific manners. So for instance, imagine this situation here. So this column in red are cells, hosts. In the paper, Joshua speaks about bacteria and bacteriophages, but doesn't matter. So you have the cells here, the hosts, and then here you have the viruses. Okay? So what type of relationships you may have between the virus and the cells? So you might have a completely random relationship, which means that this phage here can infect any bacterial genotype, and this bacterial genotype can be infected by any phage, so completely random. If you translate these interactions into an infection matrix, so here you will have in the X, you will have the phage genotype, and in the Y, you will have the bacterial species or the bacterial genotype, then every time that you get an infection, you mark a dot, so you will have a something like that, which is a random matrix. It's a random matrix with zeros and ones. What happens if you have a perfect matching between bacteria and phage, or host and parasite? So if there is a one-to-one matching, then the infection matrix is just the diagonal. Okay? Anything out the diagonal doesn't exist, so this cell is not infected by this virus, so that's why there is nothing here. But there are other options. This is an option, this is a nested infection, so it means that there is a highly susceptible bacteria in this case that can be infected by any virus. So this bacteria is susceptible to infection by every possible virus. Okay? This bacteria is susceptible to every possible virus except one. This bacteria to every possible except two. So the top bacteria is the general susceptible bacteria. Everything can infect it. And this bacteria is the most resistant one, which is only infected by one of the viruses. That actually is the most infectious virus. The most infectious virus infects everything, and the less infectious virus only infects the most susceptible bacteria. This is when you translate these interactions in an infection matrix, what you get is a hemimatrix like that. Okay? And this is a this is a nested structure. And finally, you may have something like that. So you have bacteria that are closely related genetically, and phages that are closely related genetically in such a manner that these related bacteria can be infected by all these related viruses, but not by viruses from other group. And these bacteria and these phages in the second group cannot infect bacteria from the first group. So the result of that in terms of an infection matrix is this modular matrix in which you have blocks of infection groups. Okay? There's lots of theory on that. Okay? There's a huge amount of theory modelizing this type of interactions. So this is just this figure is just expanding this situation where you have the most susceptible bacteria here, the most difficult to infect bacteria down here, and then the most susceptible bacteria can be infected by anyone, and the most hard to infect bacteria can only be infected by the most generalist viruses. So in other words, susceptible bacteria will select for specialists, and generalists and hard to infect bacteria will select for generalists. So that's the prediction of theory. If we put our small data set, I mean, if we take our small data set and put on the context of these infection matrices and networks of infection, what we get? Okay, here you have the infection matrix with the in this column are the viral lineages ranked from the most generalist to the most specialist. And here you have the host ranked from the most susceptible to the less susceptible. Okay? This is the same information here and there, but in a different manner. This is the infection matrix. This is the network, the binary network. Okay? From the most generalist viruses, Lansbury 2 and Dijon 3, to the most specialist viruses, WT1 and ST0. ST3. From the most susceptible host, ST0, to the less susceptible host, A2. This is a non-modular matrix, so it's not, but it's significantly nested. So it's almost the diagonal. So that means that generalist viruses have evolved that are able of infecting every possible ecotype of the plants, and very permissive ecotypes, okay, are available for every possible virus, whereas the generalist ecotypes, the resistant ecotypes, are only available for the most generalist virus. And this, if you go to the literature, this is what in the plant biology, in the plant pathology literature, they call a gene-for-gene interaction model. Questions? Doubts?
Anything clear?
Good. Obviously, we sequence everything, every viral lineage, I mean, and see what genetic changes we have there. So basically, this is a scheme of what we got. This is the genome. These are the lineages. Each dot represents a different mutation. You don't need to see, but they are open dots and solid dots. Open dots are synonymous mutations, and solid dots are non-synonymous mutations. and the line, the vertical lines, indicate mutation that has appeared in more than one lineage. Okay, they have been recurrently appearing in multiple lineages. There is a total of 79 mutations at 62 sites, and there is a rank of 2 to 8 mutations per lineage. There is synonymous and non-synonymous, and there are 6 convergent synonymous mutations, 3 which are exclusive of this particular ecotype, and 1 which is exclusive of this ecotype. This synonymous mutation is shared by 2 ecotypes, and this mutation is common to 3 lineages, sorry. There are 3 convergent non-synonymous mutations, which are this one, which affects this protein, the P3M PIPO, and is shared by 2 lineages, this mutation in the code protein, shared by 2 lineages, this mutation here and here, which affect the same codon. Actually, this is an interesting case because there are 2 different nucleotide substitutions affecting the same codon on the CP protein and implying 2 different amino acid replacements. Convergence at the non-synonymous level is easy to explain from a selective perspective. So you have restriction to change, and you will change whatever is available to change, and you probably change in the same way. But non-synonymous synonymous convergence are not that easy to explain from a selective perspective, and I will get a little bit later on that. If you are still with me. Genomic evolution, so if we treat each lineage as an observation and each host as a subpopulation, then you can compute some diversity indexes within host, meaning within host genotypes, in the entire sample or inter-species, and then you can calculate NAIS, a differentiation statistic, the NST, which in this case is this value here, is highly significant. Meaning that during this diversification, significant genetic differences has accumulated between genotypes, okay, of the plant, between genotypes of the plant. So that's what I say. So minor yet significant differences have been generated during this experimental diversification. To see whether this divergence is a consequence of selection of other things, we apply the Tajima-SD that Magnus explained Monday. And basically, we got a significant negative Tajima-D, together with the fact that we have 55 singletons, suggests that we are simply observing a population expansion rather than selection. So it's more compatible with population expansion, a rapid growth of the population from a common ancestor than selection. So this is just to show you that there exists a correlation between genetic variance for fitness. So this is a phenotypic variance for fitness, but the genetic component of the phenotypic variance and the molecular variance. So sometimes one asks, what is the meaning of molecular variance? Can I correlate with phenotypic variance or with fitness, variance in fitness? Otherwise, how do I know that this is real, meaningful from an evolutionary perspective? So yeah, this is a correlation. This is showing the correlation. Actually, if you remove, it's significant, but if you remove this number here, it's much more significant. It's absolutely positively correlated. So yeah. Some of the molecular variation that we are observing has a consequence in the differences in fitness that we are measuring. And now, let me get you back to what I said before about convergent synonymous mutations. So how can we explain convergent synonymous mutations? So don't have an effect on the coding sequence, if they don't affect the protein structure in any way, they should be neutral. And if they are neutral, how it is possible that different independent lineages fix the same mutation? I mean, either there is a cross-contamination, which we can discard because the genomes are different in many other positions, or there is something else. Something like these mutations are not neutral, and they have been selected. So one possibility to test is that an improvement in translational efficiency. So we maybe these synonymous mutations have changed one codon that was optimal in tobacco, but was not optimal in Arabidopsis, by a codon that is now optimal in Arabidopsis. This might be one possibility. Okay, so that will improve fitness because the virus has more access to the pool of tRNAs, and then that speeds up translation. So to test that possibility, for each one of the mutations, we compute the relative change in the codon usage bias, in the codon adaptation codon index, for the evolved, the ancestral, and so on. So if there is no changes in codon usage, then this index will be zero, whereas if it is a change in the codon usage, this index will be greater than zero. So we compute the index for synonymous and for all other mutations. For synonymous mutations, this index is 0.5, plus and minus something, whereas for all other mutations, the non-synonymous is basically zero, as expected. So if you compare these two numbers, they are significantly different. So we can conclude that among our synonymous mutations, there is an excess of mutations that change from a codon that is poorly used in in Arabidopsis, to a codon that is highly used in Arabidopsis. Okay, so it's a kind of evidence, or I mean, if you want weak, but still an evidence, a weak evidence of convergent mutation resulting in fitness effects as an improvement in the translation efficiency. Didn't know that. I was okay. So I'll ask you later for the reference. No, I was not aware of that. That's an alternative. I thought that when you mentioned an alternative, I thought they were going to say the RNA structure. No, but there is no RNA structures in this, at least in this region. Okay. So what are the consequences in terms of interaction with the different genotypes of the or ecotypes of the plant of this diversification process that we have observed experimentally? So, in other words, if now I have generalist viruses that are able of infecting all the ecotypes more or less equally well, and I have specialist viruses that only infect the most permissive host, the most permissive ecotypes. How do these translate in terms of transcriptomes, in terms of the genes that the plant turns on and off as a consequence of infection? So to answer that question and some others, we went back to the transcriptomics. Very boring stuff. So basically, I'm going to show you three analyses. In the paper, there are many more, but I'm just going to tell you about three analyses. So the first one is digging into the similarities and differences among replicated lineages in their host ecotypes. So the three lineages evolved in the same ecotype, do they respond, the plants respond in the same manner to infection with the three lineages, or there are serious differences, or they are simply the plants do not respond in an homogeneous manner to the different lineages of the virus or to the different viruses. We are going to try to say something about drivers of local versus universal adaptation, so genes that are specific of the local host versus the alternative hosts. And finally, differences among specialists, the most specialist virus and the most generalist virus. So that means that we did, remember the table with all the infections we did? So we did the transcriptomics of all that. It's a huge amount of work. So the first result, here the first test is the test of local adaptation. So basically we are interested, as I say, in seeing whether the virus is evolved in a particular ecotype. alter the expression of this ecotype in a different manner than viruses infecting alternative ecotypes. Okay? So this is again, we took the list of genes, and then we compared the list using this similarity index, and then we build, actually here was a Pearson correlation, what we use as a measure of similarity between two patterns, because here every gene is expressed. So the Pearson correlation is the metric we use here to construct the cladogram and this neighbor joining. And basically what you can see is viral lineages, they cluster together according to their host. Okay, those ST0 cluster together, A2 cluster together, WT cluster together, Lansbury-Recta cluster together, and DI cluster together. So the genotype is driving the adaptation of the corresponding lineages. So any lineage that is evolved in a particular genotype is going to be more similar to another lineage evolved on the same genotype to that any lineage evolved anywhere. Okay, so there is a local adaptation in terms of gene expression, or at least in terms of how the virus interacts with the plant. Okay. Second test. This is a little bit more complicated test. Can we detect anything that is specific of a particular genotype? Or can we distinguish, can we tell apart responses that are specific of a genotype versus responses that are shared by more than one genotype so that we can say that those are more general responses? To do so, we did the following contrasts. Basically, you take the evolved virus that has been evolved in the host H, lineage L, and you test on the genotype K minus the control, and you compare that versus the ancestral virus test on the K control and minus the corresponding control. So this is for upregulated, this is for downregulated. If you go from the outside to the inside, what you get is, for instance, A2, there are 48 genes upregulated that are exclusive of A2. There are 12 genes that are exclusive for DI2, 11 genes that are exclusive for WT1, 64 for this, and 22 for that. Those are specific responses. They are not shared by the different ecotypes. And the same is true for the downregulated genes. So there are 76 specific of DI, 19 of the WT1, 29, 48, and 2. Okay, those are specific responses of the ecotypes. As you get inside in this diagram, so there are two that are shared by DI and ST, two that are shared by DI, ST, and AE, and so on and so forth. And in the center of the diagram, what you get here is the number of functions that are upregulated in common by all ecotypes. It's only two. And here, likewise, it's none in common. And when you look at this, like say, whoa, what will be that is in common among all of them? Response to cadmium ion and photorespiration. Something. Something. No, I mean, nothing that gives us a clue on something meaningful. I mean, maybe photorespiration, because the plants have altered the photosynthesis processes are altered in all plants, so they are yellow. That's the only thing in common that I can tell you, because cadmium has nothing in our experiment. Some final contrast, and this is the more interesting, perhaps, from an evolutionary perspective, is the contrast between what does the most generalist virus and what does the most specialist virus across all possible hosts, genotypes. So the contrast here is, this is the most generalist virus, layer 0, lineage 1, and this is the contrast. So we took the virus layer... This is layer 2. Yeah, this should be a 2. So we take the virus evolved in Landsberg, lineage 2, and now we compare the response for the evolved virus across all other K hosts minus the control, And we compare that with the response of the Landwehr virus lineage 2 on Landwehr minus the control. So basically what we are looking is the similarity in the response of the Landwehr plants infected with this virus versus all the other plants infected with this virus. Okay? So, and here is what you have. So if you look at the different plants, this A2, I don't know why it's here. Okay, this should be there and ST should be here. Well, doesn't matter, has modified things. So basically, if you look at this, they are very, numbers are quite low. So zero, so there's basically no differences between the response in Landwehr plants and the response in DI plants, or WTs four, two. So there are only four genes different in the response between the DI plants and the Landwehr plants and so on, except EI2, which is a larger number, but all the other are quite small numbers. Compare with what you get with the specialist. When you look at the most specialist virus and you do the correspond the same contrast, what you get are bigger numbers. You get hundreds, 170s, 20s, 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 200s, 90s. Okay, you get bigger numbers here than here. How do we interpret this? So, and I hope you are with me on this interpretation. For the generalist virus, it is altering the expression of the same set of genes across all ecotypes. So that's why we see so many zeros there. Everything is like in Landwehr. It does the same thing in Landwehr, the local host, and in the other host. Whereas the most specialist virus, whatever it does in its local host ST0 is different from what it does to a larger extent what it does in the other ecotypes. Okay? So the specialist, the molecular basis, if you want, of being a specialist or being a generalist, is that if you are a specialist, you are going to interact with your local host in an optimized manner, which is completely different in the manner that you interact with other hosts. Whereas the strategy of a generalist is to interact with every possible host more or less in the same way. That's our interpretation. I don't know if you buy it or not. It's open to discussion. Eh? If you don't like, you can say. So basically, this is all I have to tell you. There is a few slides of some work we are doing now. There is still 10 minutes left. If you want, I can go quickly over this, because this is work in process. It's not anything is finalized. It's just to get an idea of what we keep doing now in the lab. So one thing we are doing is somehow related with the discussion that this morning of Eli, and yesterday was telling us about a spatial structure of viruses and how this might affect the rate of adaptation of viruses to different ecotypes. In the experiments we have done, in this last set of experiments with rabidopsis, we have infected one genotype and keep the virus on that genotype, and the lineages were completely isolated each other. But in nature, you think how things are in nature, you might find plots of plants of a given genotype, and then another plot of plants of a different genotype, and the virus will be moving around all these plots of plants, and then experiencing one or the other. So to mimic that, we have done an experiment, which is still going on, which basically we have six genotypes of the plant, plots of the genotype of plants of each genotype, and then we infect everything, and after a cycle of infection, we collect everything, pull together, and use this pool of viruses to infect everything. So this will be like a panmictic population of viruses. They get all together to infect the next generation of plants, whereas here, we keep them divided into DIMs. So the Columbia stays on Columbia, the GA stays in GA, and so on and so forth. And we have been keeping track of how virulence evolve in this system. And basically, you have here a figure of how virulence evolve in the mixed populations. I mean this, or in the deemed populations, which is this. So basically, I mean, they increase in virulence. If you look at infectivity, it seems to increase much faster in infectivity in the deemed populations than in the others. But I mean, we need to do replicates. You see, there is no error bars anywhere here, so we need to do the replicates. But if you just compare the rates of adaptation here and here, they are faster evolving here than there. So whatever they do when they are in a single host, they adapt faster than when you just simply mix them, because there is a migration of things into your local population that is not adapted. So when you measure fitness or virulence or whatever, they are not contributing, basically, because they are not well adapted. This is an infection matrix, but again, it's still very preliminary data. It's not much to say here, other than I don't see any clear pattern of nestedness or nothing like that. So depends on when we have more data. And another experiment we are working on now is because the RTM, the experiments I told you during the last hour and 20 minutes were on the RTM mutants, which to some extent, I'm not sure if RTM is a real resistant gene in nature, because I'm not sure. I'm really honestly, I don't know. What is the role of RTM? It's probably involved in infection, but not in infection with these viruses. So instead of that, we decided to look for more classical canonical resistance pathways. So we took a collection of mutants of Arabidopsis that are mutants in different defense pathways. Some of them, I'm not going to bore you with the details, but some are related with the ethylene messenger, ethylene response, the DCR, AGOS, and things like that involving RNAi, genes like the eukaryotic initiation factor 4G, which is involving resistance to potiviruses in Solanaceae, DIP2, COI, so a bunch of different things related with different pathways of response to infection in plants. So we took all of them, we infected with the virus, in this case TUMB, and then we classified them according to several properties of infection, like productivity of infection, severity of symptoms, time to have symptoms, and things like that, and then choose a number of them for an evolution experiment, and then we evolve the viruses on these different lineages, and it's a tiny picture, but here you see how the lineages basically increase in fitness on the different genotypes of the plant. This will be virulence, this will be infectivity, so some of them are absolutely infectious now, some of them fluctuate more or less, and this is viral load. And I mean, some basic statistics with this preliminary data show that they are, this is multivariate analysis of variants, basically tells you that there are differences between the genotype of the plant and differences between, but not differences among independent lineages, so this is kind of promising. So each genotype is selecting for each genotype of the plant is selecting for something different in the virus, and now we are in the process of characterizing what these viruses have, or how these viruses are in all other genotypes, and what are the molecular changes that these viruses has experienced, trying to understand how the diversity in antiviral responses really modulate the evolution of the virus. So this is the final slide. this is something that I already mentioned the other day. So antagonistic pleiotropy, if the virus is frequently switch host, there is no coordination. Well, permissive, this is better. Permissive ecotypes select for specialists, while restrictive ecotypes select for generalists. There is no evolved virus that might be superior to all others in every ecotype, and no ecotype is resistant against all evolved viruses, and this creates nestedness in the infection matrix, which is compatible with a gene-by-gene or gene-for-gene interaction model. generalist viruses manipulate the expression of similar genes across hosts, whereas specialists do not. And the exploration of specialization occurs faster in than the evolution of generalism in this mixed plant setup. Whatever. So and now, yeah, this is the end. So you have any question?
I know, after the lunch.